There's a few things that age like fine wine. Studio Ghibli films, actual wine, and that one jar of Alfredo sauce you bought 15 months ago when you were grocery shopping for the first time without your parents that sat in the back of the fridge waiting for you. It's still good, okay?
Okay.
There are cars out there that do just the same. The 2000 GT, the Datsun 240Z, and even the 70s Mustang. A little RV action in the Mustang makes the old pantaloons tight, okay? With that awkward transition, I'm Alex, alex.fi on Instagram, and today we're gonna be talking about one of the fine wines of the car scene. The car that you see every once in a while and go, oh yeah, I liked that car once. We're talking about the one, the only, Toyota Celica. And if you're just jumping into the channel, welcome! Don't forget to subscribe so we can keep making banging videos like this. And if you're looking for aftermarket Rams, we say wheels around here, okay? Because, well, we just recommend that, okay? Tires or suspension, be sure to check out fitmentindustries.com, where we have everything from Cosmos Racing to Toyo to coilovers and even air suspension if you want to be a cool kid, because it's pretty much what we do for either your newly acquired Toyota Celica or not. All right. Anyway, with that plug out of the way and just saving you the Squarespace ad because those are everywhere right now, let's get into it. The Toyota Celica was produced from 1970 to 2006, which actually means celestial or from the heavens, if you will. Just, it's a motivational name. And my mom had one of these, by the way, and she was a badass, okay? Back in the mid 60s, Toyota and Yamaha were having a grand old time with the 2000 GT, the classic car that everyone dreams of having, but unfortunately due to this thing called money, wasn't really able to ever actually purchase. Anyway, Toyota wanted to find a way to bring that sports car-esque to a model that allowed the everyday driver to enjoy their old commute, okay? They looked across the ocean and found that Ford was doing that with their Mustang and Chevy was close behind doing it with their Camaro. So Toyota thought, hey, let's take one from the old classic boy book from over the seas and took the 2000 GT, stripped it down, and pretty much turned it into the Toyota Celica. The Celica was launched at the 1970 Toyota Motor Show and was truly Toyota's answer to the pony cars from across the seas. Never intended to be a high-volume car, the Toyota Celica was quite the unique vehicle. It offered a unique little driving experience. The US variant in 1971 came in 1.9 liter, and it would take a few years for the size to get upgraded, but when the GT and ST trims hit the States, and even overseas, it pretty much conquered. The car was truly meant to be a budget buy that didn't sacrifice much to make you smile. And in 1977, Celica announced that it had produced over 1 million models. And that was a big deal back then for an international little sports car. The first generation was quite the looker too. It had a chrome front bumper, pillarless windows, and a rear end that made it look quicker than it actually was. It got hit by a little bit of an ugly stick when you started going through the generations, but it did okay. The second generation was introduced in 78 and focused on safety, power, and economy because the EPA was over there ruining all the fun. And although it won Motor Trend's Car of the Year in 1978, the car began to hit a little bit of an interesting period. The rear end would get a little bit longer for storage. EPA regulations made it less of a sports car and more of a well-rounded car that just kind of felt fun. The stick that the second generation got hit with wasn't necessarily Toyota's fault. It was the styling of the 80s and it was paired with the added safety equipment, and that's just how she ended up coming out looking, okay? But then the third generation came out. The third generation changed massively to the previous generations, and it came with a 2.4 liter versus the 2.2 of the previous generation, but it continued to break away from the first generation's original intentions. The third generation would see a turbo model get launched in Japan, and Toyota would even enter the car into the World Rally Championship to see what it could do. Now, even though Toyota began to realize they were making the Celica pretty much everything besides a sports car, so they reintroduced the GTS into the lineup, which would give the model some much needed love that would make an auto enthusiast proud again, maybe even cry. There was even a GTR and a GTTR model that was exclusive to the Japanese market because they're lucky bastards. In the rally world, the Celica did well. It would win with a modified GTR Celica and an extremely modified engine back in the day. There's a fourth generation. There it is. Not much with it. It's actually one of the lesser popular Celicas, but mostly because it had some odd changes done to it. But at the time, it did make sense. It had a rounded body style, front wheel drive, 116 horsepower, four wheel independent suspension, okay? The Japanese market would get some neat trims, but here in the old US of A, we got
none of them.
Toyota did make a banger of a motor for its Japanese models, though, as the 3S GE, which put out 186 horsepower, which was one of the highest rated horsepower cars that came out of a 2-liter four-cylinder. But then, Toyota. Toyota won the lottery in the late 80s. In case you're wondering why the innovative Japanese cars came out in the 90s, it's because the Japanese economy was truly at its peak, and the world was watching. As a result, Toyota was stuffing all of their love into the Supra, and close behind it, the Celica. The Celica would get the true round of love with the fifth generation when it came out in the early 90s. It had an angry front end, had anti-lock brakes, it had leather interior, it had a sunroof, and almost 200 horsepower. What? The amount of trims that came out for the Celica was insane. You had the SR, the All-Track, the ZR, the GTR, the GT4, you had the twin turbo models, you had the models with the viscous coupling, limited slip differentials, you had the STs, you had the GTs, and probably some more than I'm probably missing. It had the floppy headlights, it had the traditional styling you would come to see and love about JDM cars that really hit the Celica, and it looked good. Now, you remember that meme that you saw 400 times on the car meme websites, and like the Nicolas Cage's face and the corner of the red Celica, and he was like, that's this generation. The sixth generation would follow in 1994 and would last about 5 years. This would be about as close as Toyota would be willing to let the Celica get to the Supra. Get to the Supra. And you can almost see it just by the front end. And although the US would only get the ST and GT trims again, there were still fun trims being made elsewhere. They would continue to kick power up in the European and Japanese models to nearly 250 nickels, okay, with the 3S GTE engine. The power and push came directly from Toyota's continuing involvement in the World Rally Championship, and that much really began to drip into the trim levels of the everyday Celica. Now, the sixth generation is probably the second most popular generation Celica ever made, especially for us, and it was a properly good car. But as time began to pass in the 90s, the growing piggy bank that Toyota used to really bring the Celica into the sunlight began to fade, mostly because the Japanese market began to crash. Now, late 90s models would begin to see their trim levels get slashed until only a few remained. Now, the latest generation Celica would be the last one we would see to grace our presence. It was aggressive, it featured a loud, aggressive hood. Okay, it had front lip intakes, and it was Toyota's attempt to bring in a newer, younger audience that dabbed and loved flossing, okay, and getting back in bed for a lovely one-night stand with Yamaha to partner in on the engineering. You would see the economy 1.8 liter 140 horsepower engine, or a GTS engine, come into the fray, and it did this by using some advanced valve timing. Now, even the most recent generation being in literally every Need for Speed game ever possibly made, it still really wasn't enough, and lots of people saw this as Toyota's way to scale down the model, become less invested, and of course, more affordable. At the time, Toyota would be competing with the likes of the S2000, and didn't stand much of a chance. Toyota would hit the line in 2006 and pretty much call it quits, in addition to its brother, the MR2, also getting cut. There's a little bit of competition in the field, and they didn't work out enough to play, okay? History is over, and we're done. There's a lot of history in the six generations, but if you want more details, or more than our Spark Notes, Wikipedia is a damn good resource of information, and I don't care what Mr. Richards says in English class, Wikipedia is pretty damn good. Anyway, we're here to talk to you about wanting to own one of these classic boys, okay? Well, put down the Toyota hat and grab your favorite handmade 10mm as we jump into this somewhat underrated, yet awkwardly placed car in the automotive scene. The various generations of the Toyota Celica all have their pros and cons. The first few generations were littered with history and style, even the third generation. Now, of course, because of their age, they aren't all that popular anymore for the young bucks out there. That and their motors are a bit of an acquired taste now to work on, since the early ones were carbed and the newer ones are just a little bit weird. Popularity begins to spike once you start jumping into the mid-1980s. Now, these cars are truly fun to drive, especially considering how they're built. They have the long nose, they got the short rear, it helps you makes you feel like you're going fast when you're really not. And because Celicas aren't too expensive, you can jump into one without much of a fuss and have fun with it. Modifications for some of those mid, you know, the third, fourth, fifth generation usually tend to stay around the period correct styling. Things like work wheels are super common. RPF1s. But even on the fourth and fifth generation, really modifying them aren't super duper popular. You don't get too crazy until the seventh generation, and that's the one from Need for Speed. God, the memories. I remember listening to Get Low and having no idea that there would be sweat going down any part of me, but hey, you don't understand much when you're like 10. The 7th generation can actually look properly good as long as you keep the modifications moderate. The car stock is actually super aggressive for its time, and since it's from the early 2000s, it can be super easy to make them look a little bit dated with some aftermarket stuff. Some might say rice. We see tons of people throw BC Racing coilovers on these things, some XXRs or ESRs, and then some Falcon tires to call it good. Pair that with a moderate GT wing and you're pretty much set to rock and roll. And since it's a Toyota, the reliability for the initial generations is pretty good, with most repairs being able to be done with a few tools and your ears, because you gotta listen to the timing. However, the latest generation did have some issues with a funky oil pump that caused the Yamaha Toyota motor to pretty much blow up. It was a pretty disastrous issue with some of these motors and resulted in some pretty hefty repairs. So if you're looking to snag one of the latest generations, you're gonna wanna make sure that the oil pump was repaired and the supporting rebuilds were done as well. The cars themselves are pretty easy to get into. They're easy to modify and they're somewhat easy to own, as long as the motors are maintained and repaired prior to blowing up. After all, Toyota made a little over 4 million of these. The one thing is, with the Toyota Celica, especially from the point of view of, well, modifying cars, because that's kind of what we do with wheel tires and suspension, it's not that many people would modify these cars anymore. They're somewhat stuck in the early 2000s in terms of a community. The generations of Celicas are all neat cars, okay? With their own little bits of history throughout. And they did very, very well. However, the Celica is turning more into an acquired taste versus a hidden gem. And if you're looking to snag one, try to find one that's either imported from the mid-90s when Toyota was at its peak, or an early generation one, as they're an absolute blast to drive and they're pretty fun to work on. Newer generations likely have the most modifications available, but really at the price points of all the generations, the older ones may butter your croissant just a little bit more. Plus, nobody likes it when their motors blow up. So let us know in the comments what you think about the Celica, and of course tell us what car you'd like to see us cover next. If you just picked up a Celica and you're looking for wheels, tires, or suspension, be sure to hit us up at fitmentindustries.com, where we pretty much have everything. It's pretty neat. Or maybe you're just looking up to pick up a tea. We don't judge. Either way, I'm Alex from Fitment Industries. We will see you later. Peace.